to highlight that we absolutely recognise that this is a very much a long-term strategy. There is a huge amount of work to do around this. So although I think we have made some significant progress and this is really good work for last year, you know, we absolutely recognise that there is still a long way to go. And particularly around domestic abuse and some of those other issues that I think are very much entrenched and we do have a lot of tolerance around that. So we put that out just to highlight what we have been able to do, and as I say, I think there were some really positive stories in there. We held an event as well, so my commitment that I made last year when we launched the plan was around making sure that we reported back to victims and survivors who had helped us to shape the plan and talk to them about what work we've done, what their experiences have been, do they feel like anything's changing. So we did that event with victims and survivors and also our third sector partners. And it was really positive. They've given us a good steer in terms of where we focus for the next 12 months. And then we also did an event on the 25th of November, which was the UN Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women and Girls. And we held a vigil. And I'm conscious that, you know, colleague Warren Rudd were there as well, which is really welcome. Just, I guess, to remind ourselves around the scale of the challenge and remember the women who have been lost because of male violence. And so that was a very kind of moving event as well. So I was grateful to have attended that. But yes,
I'm
happy to take questions, Chair.
Thanks. I just think it's really good that there is a focus on it for 16 days, isn't it? And
yes.
I can only speak for the local authority, both internally and externally on social media. We are putting out messages every day. And I think it's that kind of focus, but restating it, is very useful because I think one off often gets lost and other things happen. So I've really welcomed the approach this year and I thought the gathering at Manhattan was very nice as well. It's a way of showing other people. You know, I'd like to have seen more women there, but maybe that's going to be a measure going forward if it becomes an annual event perhaps.
Yes, I mean there was a vigil held last year and it was organised by a different group and we kind of took the lead on it this year, but I think, yeah, we recognised that we maybe didn't quite promote as much as we could have done or there were potentially more audiences we could have drawn in, so I think we are keen to learn from that and see if there's more we can do next year. I think it's a challenge because the day itself, I am keen that we make it an annual event, but obviously it changes. So it was a Saturday afternoon this time, when it's a weekday, you know, we might have to do it at a slightly different time. So it's just trying to work through the logistics of how we get it to a regular cycle. But yes, I was pleased if he was there, but yeah, we are keen to grow the audience next time.
Brian?
So it's very much driven by the plan, so the plan that we launched last year, which had the 57 actions in, some which are more kind of achievable than others for various reasons. So I think it's about trying to listen to victims and survivors and tell us, you know, where we feel like work is being done great, but actually are there still some gaps? So I think for me, there's still some real challenges around domestic abuse, and so a lot of the work we've done has been driven by some of the funding that we've been able to access. So the Safer Streets campaign, for example, which has been very much around you know, public transport, safety in the nighttime economy, you know, women and girls moving around the city centre or moving around the region. But actually I'm really conscious that we need to not forget about, you know, domestic abuse and sexual violence that's happening in the home and behind closed doors, which is often harder to tackle. So we're really trying to look at how we can develop a better funding model for that and look at how we can really try and get to some of the perpetrator work, which we started to do this year. But again, it's very much driven by what funding we can get to try and tackle it. So I think it's very much looking at how we can maybe move some of those areas forward that we haven't done as much this year. So we are trying to focus on all of them, but we recognise that we're not going to do all 57 in 12 months. So.
Now, you mentioned 57. What's your feel bit behind private tools and how they've got private teams? Or as a team, do you actually review and lay them out?
So it's a partnership strategy, so we have a governance structure that sits behind it. So we have different strategic groups that look at the different strands of violence against women and vulnerabilities, and then that is all reported up to my strategic board, so then we will basically oversee kind of where progress is made around that. But the idea is that it's not just about me, it's very much a partnership strategy. So all the partners around the table will be holding each other to account to challenge each other in terms of what progress they're being made. So what are the police doing around training and reporting that back to the partnership? You know, what are other agencies doing around early intervention and education and things like that? So it's being monitored at those different subgroups, and it's their responsibility to kind of keep an eye on progress against each of those.
Thank you.
transport at night, because people are vulnerable. There's been quite a bit of work done since that survey was carried out in summer of 2021, so we've had 2 years. Firstly, do you know what figures might be today? Secondly, if you don't, are there plans for a follow-up survey?
We haven't repeat the survey as yet. I think it's something we are considering. The police are doing quite a lot of work around surveying the public around feeds of the safety and things like that. So it's probably something that we will try and tap into to see if there's learning that we can take from that. And it's something that we'll pick up. I find that, you know, the Safer Streets project, it only just got going towards the end of 2021, and then we got the second round of funding to roll it out. So I find that you need to give a couple of years for these projects to try and take effect and see how it's impacting. So I wasn't in a rush to do the same survey again, but it will be something we look at in terms of how we see whether we have made an impact or not.
Okay, great. Can I just ask, because I know with the second council, we need to throw our weight behind the white ribbon campaign, which is a nationally recognised campaign. Is your office firmly sort of aligned with that campaign or affiliated with that campaign, or is it that you're doing similar work just at the same time?
Yes, I think it's not something we support it. You know, I think there are colleagues in the office who very much will support White Ribbon Day. I think the White Ribbon is a very particular campaign around kind of led by men, saints, and men, we need to be part of the solution. So I very much welcome that part of the conversation. I think my focus, where we can talk about this the same day as the UN Day, the Elimination of Violence Against Women and Girls, I think my focus is very much about women's voices and making sure they're very much at the heart of it. So I think it's about making sure that they're heard, and then we kind of will embrace what the White Ribbon campaign do in addition to that, because absolutely, men have to be part of the conversation. So it's about making sure that the women's voices are the ones that are kind of leading the way, and then White Ribbon campaign sits as part of that. So yes, absolutely, we support events in all sorts of ways around that.
Thanks, thank you.
Are there any other questions on this report? Can we endorse this working report? I think it's really good. It is an important quite a lot to be achieved. So delighted to receive that report. Are we okay with that, members?
Thank you.
I'm from Tracy. Community First Programme, can you take us through the update for this commission? Thank you.
So this is just a brief update, really. It follows on from the governance framework that the panel have had previously. It just basically highlights the process for how the police will internally manage change. So obviously there are decisions that have to be made around savings and how we balance the budget, but also teams have to be expanded as well. It's making sure there's a clear process, and I have a role to play as part of that. The key area is if there is to be any growth. So if they want to make decisions that will increase spending by £300,000, and that's a cumulative impact, so as soon as they hit that threshold, I have to sign off any investment above that. So it just gives you a highlight, really, as to the process of how we do that. I will say as well, one of the areas that we are particularly focused on is what we call benefits realisation. But basically, when the police have approved these schemes, all these different projects and initiatives that have gone through in different parts of the force, how are they then assessing that, evaluating that? And so we've recently been asking for more information around what are the benefits? Have you seen the efficiencies or the effective kind of delivery increase, which is what you would anticipate in a business case? So it's basically just an outline of the process and how we monitor that.
Thank you, Commissioner. Are there any questions? Brian?
Sorry. I knew you'd have questions.
A good piece of work. We're looking at credit.
So as part of each proposal, they have a business case. So as part of the business case, they have a very thorough assessment which will look at risks and benefits. So absolutely, they will factor in, well, actually, if we cut this team off, we make these changes, what impact will that have? And they do that both, whether it's spending or cutting. So yes, that's some of the work that they will present to us is where they identify those risks. Yeah, so that piece of work around the evaluation, the benefits realisation, that's what we're doing. So actually we've asked now for them to make sure they're presenting kind of, you know, maybe 6-12 months, whenever the right point will come, once a kind of a change has been initiated, we will then be able to sit down and say, right, well, what has the outcome been? Have you seen the benefits, or have the risks been what you expected? So we have that kind of in place now to review some of that.
So what we're having in place when we've got the preset, that will affect the overall spend that we've got for the next couple of
years? Yes, so obviously, I mean, we'll be coming back to you in February, I think, with the budget report and preset proposal, but yes, whatever the outcome of the policing kind of setup will be, which we'll find out next week, and then whatever then we approve from the preset point of view, that will then be factored into the wider budget work that John will lead on, and that will affect what budget the chief has going forward as well. Going forward, they will be to make cash flow savings, which are fairly easy to about to take, but the savings are taken out straight away, and then you can see that it's difficult productivity. It's more reward hours available to the chief company to deliver that way. So that's the process we're going to get going through. But where something's been approved and the savings have been identified, they will be reflected in the budget and also the MGMS going forward, and you see those.
Any more questions on this item? No. Can we therefore endorse it and hand the Commission for that report? Item 3D, decision is made by the Peace and Quiet Commission. Same suit report, please, Commissioner. Thank you.
Yes, so these are the decisions that I've taken since the last meeting. I think you've covered some of them in detail throughout the report and in other areas, but I'm happy to answer any questions.
Tony?
Thank you. Just on the youth diversion from Emily, about is there any evidence, if you like, about the mitigating the antisocial behaviour over the sort of Halloween and Horrifying Night period. I referred to my first contributions today, there's significant problems in that particular area. And I know, for example, in Watford and the Borough, there's a firework through a letterbox in the house and so on. So, and then is there a general report on the effectiveness of the bids? For example, in my ward, I wasn't aware of any agencies other than Burnham and that sort of thing, which might possibly be able to engage in with people. And if there's any kind of good practice in bringing groups together, like in schools or whatever, to try to involve young people over the period and keep them away from dangerous situations.
So yes, I mean, in terms of the initial reporting, as we were discussing earlier, we have seen the police reports drop for a couple of those key dates within that period. There will be a full evaluation report that I will get back from my team, which I think is due in January. So I haven't got a full detail breakdown of it yet, but that would involve going to the agencies that we funded and trying to find out who engaged, how many, and feedback from young people themselves as well. And it is quite striking sometimes how many of them will say, if I wasn't here, I'd be out throwing eggs or doing something I shouldn't be. So I think it is, we'll see what feedback is in terms of how effective that is. In terms of kind of being involved and engaged, we do try and make sure that as many
there's a pressure at all level. If the demand continues at that level, we don't have to put more units. If we continue, 40 grow is a great sign coming from what we
I think as well, I mean, yes, one of the options is we have to try and put more money into it. Well, the other option is people will just have to wait longer. There will be a limit to how much more funding we'll be able to find in the, you know, the long term if we can't get a sense of managing the demand. So there might also be a point where actually it will affect how long people are waiting to get interviews and things. So I think we're trying to learn, as John says, we're kind of working through it to make sure that it's working effectively and that we're maximising the money that we're putting into it.
Jennifer?
Well,
as you might have
sort of
covered it in that,
there
wasn't sure whether to switch the mic or not. Thank you. So yeah, I was wondering whether it was an increased need for we being better at recognising the need, because I know there's a lot of work being done generally about timing custody and lots of other things out there right across the board. If we're being proactive and using services better for the safety, are there any other revenue streams that can, you know, and hesitate to use ticking the boxes up because I mean in the meaningful way rather than in the way to do it to get to the end of the line. But I can see a lot of the work that's coming through, so I'm sure you will explore, but I'm not for a second suggesting that I'm suggesting this to you. I just wondered whether there's any hope of that being on the horizon, whether this is a national problem, because occasionally you just find that a lot of money comes into these things.
It's definitely not unique to Merseyside, it's definitely a national challenge. So we work quite closely with the National Appropriate Adult Network. And as the PCCD for custody, we come to this issue quite a bit. The challenge we've got, as John alluded to, is that for children there is a statutory responsibility for local authority to provide that appropriate adult. For adults who are vulnerable, that nobody does apply. There's no statutory responsibility except that, you know, the police cannot interview somebody who doesn't have an appropriate adult in place. So there are a few PCCs around the country who are funding this because they recognise that if they don't, the impact then on the police being able to run effective custody suite is huge. So I think I think a lot of PCCs are seeing this demand go up and up and up. So I think there's probably going to be more pressure in terms of we have to find a clearer solution for who exactly is to for funding this. Because the other challenge as well, in the decision taken by my predecessor Jane, because of the need to make sure it was in place, but there is some argument that says, are the PCCs the right people to fund it because it should be independent? You know, it should be very much separate from kind of police funding and things like that. So it's definitely probably something that needs further conversation, which we are having at national level.
Which
is.
Are there any further questions on this issue?
I would just say on that last point, decision 52, our concerns were really around the fact that some reserves would get used. So John will really welcome the fact that some of them would get more closely. Other ways of saving getting this money. Thank you. Item 4. Governance arrangements and an update on the issues and recommendations made by the Peace and Plan Panel. Commissioner, could you take us through the report, please? Thank you.
So I think most of what is in there we've covered in this meeting. So I think hopefully that's answered all the questions that were highlighted. Brian, I know you came in and had a conversation, didn't you, with Kim in my office to talk about the monitoring delivery. So we're obviously, you know, making sure that we reflect on that as well, and I think that was helpful. But I think everything else is up to date. So that's it, questions.
Brian?
Just for the panel, I've been to a meeting with Kim actually.
Good.
And we went through the dashboard, and she went through the process, and she did the dashboard.
Mm.
And the dashboard
Peter.
If Brian's happy, we're happy. Page 16, the three successful bids for the Home Office State of Streets Fund.
Yes.
In particular, press club, is, of course, with Shakespeare and all, there's a press club attracting people to, not just across Merseyside, but across the Northwest. So, with that sort of funding, further afield than just the Essex or those the area, so just to mention that really and to thank you for that.
Yeah, great book.
Yes, briefly on the item regarding responses and the victim care officer, what have you. And there's a reference to the wrong crime, which I think I mentioned at the last meeting, what
yeah.
before that. And so will they have to be recorded separately? The force come back to you about individual statistics related to rural crime?
So there is already, in relation to broader crime recording, yes, there is a dedicated kind of rural wildlife team now within Merseyside Police, and in terms of recorded crimes, yes, there is a way that they can record that and we can monitor that. In terms of specifically around the victim care team, and because that was in relation was questions in relation to that. They are still working on their kind of database recording to be able to pull off, kind of key sets of data that will tell us kind of how many, what types of crimes and things like that. So that is probably still a work in progress in terms of breaking that down. But in terms of the actual crime reports, yes, the police do have that and we can ask about when we need it.
Just on the press bubble, because I just do happen to know, to come back to Peter's point, the windows at the theatre are frequently broken and they cost hundreds of thousands of pounds to repair. So I think this is an important investment. And also when I've been up there, you can see the shopping precinct is very underused, there's lots of empty units. And I think those kind of situations do actually, I don't know, I wouldn't say encourage, but that they seem to be part of the profile of ASB where people can hang around. The cover of the precinct and nobody there. So I welcome actually that investment in Prescott because I do believe the new theatre will help the fortunes of that part of the world. So I'm happy with that. Any other questions on this? Okay, can we accept the report and endorse it, please? And at that point, Commissioner?
Yeah.
You and your team may escape. Can I wish you all a very happy Christmas?
Yes, you too.
Thank you
very much.
Can we now look at item 5, please? Panel mid-year financial update. David, could you take us through this, please?
Thanks, Chair. We usually bring in financial update to the panel twice a year, and that marries up with the way grant funding is allocated. It's done on a half-yearly basis. So this update relates to the claim that we put in for the first half year in 23-24, so it covers the April to September period. Section 3 of the report reminds members of how the panel host authority is supported through grant funding. It reiterates the point that the figure that the host authority receives has remained unchanged since the panel was established. So that £64,340 figure is the same grant that was available to the panel in its first years. So section 4 of the report gives an indication of what the total of the half year claim was for the first half of this year and compares it with last year. You can see the bottom line figure there in piece. Now, a lot of that can be attributed to the fact that last year's first half year claim did not include the 2022-23 pay settlement impact. So that has come on board and has influenced the cost in 23-24. The thing to highlight though is the 23-24 first half year does not include this year's pay settlement, which has recently been settled. So that will only come in on the second half year. What I guess it highlights, Chair, is that there is a strong likelihood that the direction of travel that we've had in recent years in terms of the cost of supporting the panel and the funding available to support it, there is a variance between what we spend on supporting you and actually what we receive back as a host authority in terms of grant funding. Last year that figure ended up being just over £5,000. We're anticipating that that's likely to double, if not more, to in excess of £10,000 this year. So that is an issue that I think we flagged up with the panel before, but it's unlikely to reduce. Clearly we had a discussion with last year's panel around potentially reducing the amount of activity the panel does to fit within the resource envelope that's remained the same for a decade. Last year's panel were not inclined to do that because they felt that an appropriate balance had been struck. Other option would be to lobby central government in relation to it. We have done that previously to very little effect over the last 10 years. The other option is to explore further with the constituental authorities whether there is a solution that might be brokered that shares that additional expense, so it's not just being covered by the host authority. So the report is really here for the panel's information, for you to understand how that grant funding has been spent in the first year and how that's been reflected in the first half of the year. Happy to take any questions.
Thanks, David. I'd just say, because, you know, it's over 10 years, isn't it? Cost of living, inflation, wage bills, to get the same support for the same amount of money is just not going to happen. And I know we have been in touch with government and they don't seem to be willing to take that on board. So I think it is a case of us going back to our local authorities and at least opening up informal conversations to see if there is any willingness, because the cost is such that it would be easier if it could be spread as opposed to just the host authority picking up that bill each year, because it's not going to go away. There will be more inflation and there will be more wage increases, and I don't think we can do business any more efficiently than we are doing. You know, to do a good job, we do literally have to focus in on the panels and the pillars and the way we do on the work programme. So, any comments from any of the members with regard to this?
Let's try the government route and see if they give us their make up the shortfall. Plan B is ask the councils, and Plan C, I'm not quite sure who's got a Plan C up there.
I think Plan C is Knowsley Council. We can, of course, contact them out again. I think it would just be a case of changing the date on the letter or the email. The same request, but the figures are more demanding this time around, David. So let's do that, but let's also have those informal conversations back at the local authorities, whereby we just have a quick word with our leaders, see if there's any willingness. There are five of us, so, you know, it could come down to